This is what cities in the world's most populous country look like during this new coronavirus outbreak. Millions of people in China have been ordered to stay indoors or banned from traveling in an attempt to stop the disease from spreading. But from the city of Wuhan, where the first patient came from, coronavirus infections have spread to several continents. So why is it so hard to contain these outbreaks? And are we ready for the next one? This strain of the coronavirus is believed to have spread from animals to humans, and then from humans to humans by droplets from sneezing or coughing. The World Health Organization says that so far, it has a low mortality rate. The flu, for example, kills thousands of people every year. But this coronavirus strain is new, and it is infectious, which is why it's being taken so seriously. As of February 2020, about 60 million people, more than the entire population of Spain, are being quarantined in their homes in China. It's a massive feat, but some fear that isolating that many people together could backfire.
First of all, you can't wall off a germ. It's simply impossible.
Lawrence Gostin is a professor of global health law at Georgetown University and a director at the World Health Organization's Center on Global Health Law.
Can you imagine if you were forced to be congregated in with 50 million people in a hot zone of contagion, how you would feel? You would feel you were a guinea pig. You would feel panicky. You would worry about getting food, water, essential medicines. You couldn't get to a hospital, and you were walled off from the world.
Professor Gostin worries about a breakdown in public trust. If the public doesn't trust the solutions being offered by officials, then they aren't solutions at all. For example, in the West African Ebola outbreak, many people stopped reporting when they were getting sick. They didn't trust the foreign health workers who were cordoning patients off from the rest of society, especially since many were dying in quarantine. And so the outbreak continued to spread. Many people were infected and more died. But even if there is full cooperation between officials and the population at risk, it's hard to contain an outbreak like the coronavirus.
We're less safe because we're globally interconnected in a way that we've never ever been before.
In 1950, 750 million people lived in urban areas globally. Today, that number is more than 4 billion. People are living closer together, many in overcrowded areas, making it easier for disease to spread from human to human. And our modern transport infrastructure means a virus that would have been geographically contained in the past can now get from one side of the globe to another in just a few hours. In 2003, another coronavirus epidemic called SARS spread from China.
There's actually four times greater international travel by Chinese citizens now than there was during SARS.
But transport technology is generally a good thing, and people will keep moving to urban areas. What's more, viruses are always mutating into new strains. So in reality, we can't avoid outbreaks. We just need to get better at dealing with them.
We tend to lurch from complacency to panic and overreaction. And so when we're in a major outbreak like we are now with the coronavirus, we tend to react and overreact and try to just catch up and respond. But then, as soon as things calm down, we withdraw funding, we withdraw planning, we withdraw preparedness. So isn't it a much, much better way to prepare for an epidemic and to prevent it and detect it early?
So if the solution is to be proactive rather than reactive, what can we do? Until a vaccine is discovered for this strain of the coronavirus, you can protect yourself and others by covering your mouth when coughing or sneezing, washing your hands frequently, and if you develop symptoms, avoiding contact with others until you're cleared by a doctor. That's what you can do, but governments need to do more, and they need to do it together. There's no real way to force a government to work with global health organizations if it doesn't want to. For example, during the SARS epidemic, Chinese officials hid the extent of the outbreak from both the Chinese public and the world. That led to many more people being infected. This time round, lessons seem to have been learned. China informed the World Health Organization and its own citizens of this new coronavirus relatively quickly. It also sequenced the virus's genome and shared that information with scientists around the world, who have begun working on trying to find a vaccine.
We used to not have effective vaccines. We didn't have effective antiviral medications. Now we can rapidly develop those. So, yes, we're very much less safe, but we have the technical capacity to be safer.
But the problem with any defense is that it's only as strong as its weakest link. And we live in a world where access to healthcare and healthy environments is not equal.
If you asked any thoughtful epidemiologist, what is the single greatest predictor of a human being's health? He would say the postal code. Where you live matters. And it's not just the differences in health systems and public health infrastructure between high income and low and middle income countries. There are also vast inequities within countries for those who are living in well-heeled neighborhoods and those that are living in squalor. This is simply immoral, unjust.
That's a problem, even in the world's richest country, where many people avoid going to the doctor because of how expensive American healthcare can be. That's tragic enough by itself, but in an epidemic, it might be disastrous. If we're going to be proactive in our fight against these outbreaks, improving healthcare quality for everyone might be the best strategy we've got.
Health equality matters. And it matters a lot, not just for the individual, not just for the community, not only for the country, but for the globe.